Welcome to our all-age service as we continue looking at the Lord's Prayer with "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." A lovely cheery start to the day. But this is truly an all-age service with lots of input from our younger members. But we're going to start with a prayer. If I can come up on the screen. I'll read the first line, and then if everyone could respond with the words in bold. Come everybody, gather to worship. Everybody's welcome. God is here. Come if you're weary, hungry, or thirsty. Everybody's welcome. God is here. Bring your rejoicing, dancing, and singing. Everybody's welcome. God is here. All shapes, bring your failures, questions, and sorrows. Everybody's welcome. God is here. All shapes and sizes, faces, and backgrounds. Everybody's welcome. God is here. All to the glory of Jesus our Saviour. Everybody's welcome. God is here. Now we're going to start with three songs, and the first one is an action song. We did it here the last time Steve and I led a service. Very simple actions, so if you can bear it, have a go at following them. I will stand on the stage. If anybody like Etty would like to come and join me and join in the actions, that would be rather lovely. Otherwise, I will just stand by myself. So if you're able, please stand and join us in worship.
Yeah.
don't know how many of you also share my love for the old hymns, and all the words suddenly come back from when I used to sing that at school, and the truth never changes, and it's nice to be reminded of that. So as we are still working through the Lord's Prayer, and in keeping with the decision we've made, every week we will pray the Lord's Prayer here. That will now come up on the screen, and we will all pray it together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. During my talk, Janet will be coming round and inviting children to read out some of the Bible quotes, so they are all getting involved. When Steve and I were told that we were going to be covering the lines in the Lord's Prayer, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, we both immediately thought very different thoughts. I'll leave it to Steve to tell you his brilliant idea. Needless to say, as with most of Steve's brilliant ideas, I vetoed it. My immediate thought was that I was going to have to confess to all of you here my complete inability to resist the temptation of Marmite crisps. But before I get to that, I realised that there was a more important issue I wanted to start with. Ever since I began taking my faith seriously about 30 years ago, I was struck by one line in the Lord's Prayer that didn't make sense to me. Firstly, a reminder that Jesus himself started off his teaching in this prayer with these words.
This then is how you should pray, Matthew 6:9.
It's not a long prayer, so every word counts. Jesus did not leave us with millions of his own words from his time on earth, so they all count. He never said anything ambiguous. So we get to the line that baffled me.
Lead.
Lead.
Us.
Us.
Not.
Not.
Into.
Into.
Temptation.
Temptation.
Brilliant, Mathieu. What's that? Great reading. Thank you. It had never crossed my mind that God would lead me into temptation at all. It just didn't sound like the sort of thing he would do. And sure enough, when I checked, I found this.
When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. James 1:13.
So why does Jesus want us to pray this? Well, I'm not the only one who found this line tricky. In fact, in 2017, in the Roman Catholic Church, a church that is known for resisting change to century-old traditions, Pope Francis approved a change to this line of the Lord's Prayer to...
Do not let us fail into temptation.
Needless to say, all of the individual Catholic churches completely ignored this, as they tend to ignore any recommendations for change, and stuck to the original wording. But the point he made was helpful to people like me. Rather than just reading a verse in isolation, we have to remember everything Jesus said and told us about himself and his Father, and read his words in that context. Okay. Now, not long ago, in another all-age service, we all heard about Jesus saying,
I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
We know that following the way of Jesus will always take us on a good path, the perfect path, and will always lead us towards God. So by asking God not to lead us into temptation, we're saying we need him to lead us away from the wrong path we're on and back onto his path. We know that God has the power to defeat any tempter, and he has the power to strengthen our resolve against any tempter. So we're asking for his help, because, oh my goodness, temptation is hard to resist, and every single one of us has been defeated by temptation at some point. Most of us fail at this daily. Your weaknesses may not be the same as mine. This is my crack. Now, I'm a massive fan of Marmites, and several years ago, a friend bought me a six-pack of these crisps. I opened one bag and finished it in seconds. I mean, wow, they were amazing. After my friend had left, I ate the remaining 5 bags, one after the other, and frankly, I could have eaten another 6 packs if I'd had them. I decided not to buy these again, as I was clearly unable to control myself. But every few months or so, they'd catch my eye in Sainsbury's, and I would buy another pack, but I'd resolve firmly that I would eat only 1 pack a day over 6 days, so not too overindulgent. First time I did this, I managed to stick to 1 pack on the first day, but then woke up the next morning early, already obsessing over how soon I could have my second pack. And yes, you'd guessed, I'd finished the remaining 5 packs before breakfast. This has gone on for years. Now, God doesn't leave me to mar my crisps, although I'm really hoping they will be piled high in heaven. But when I pray, lead me not into temptation, I'm admitting to him that I simply can't help going after things that I want, even though I know they're not good for me and certainly not what God planned for me. I'm telling him that I rely on his wisdom and power to lead me in another direction. Incidentally, when I told Steve I was going to be talking about this, he was stunned. He had absolutely no idea that my passion for these crisps was quite so crazy. Steve hates Marmite, so I've never eaten any form when he's in the room as the smell is too much for him. But we came up with a good way to deal with my complete lack of self-control. So with this 6-pack, I'm going to give them to Steve so he can give them to me 1 pack at a time, 1 day at a time. He's really going to love the power he holds over me. But there's a more serious form of temptation that I frequently overlook. I think I've lied to myself that the only temptations that defeat me are harmless ones like Marmite crisps. But when Jesus was tempted by Satan in the wilderness, he wasn't just presented with a series of delicious foods. In Matthew 8, we read this.
Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All this I will give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord for God and serve him only.
Thank you, Etty. That's beautifully read. This is part of Jesus' temptation in the desert, and we may well think that this is irrelevant to us as we're unlikely to be important enough to Satan to be offered all the kingdoms of the world in exchange for a bow. But Jesus immediately sees that in this instance, the actual temptation is to worship and serve someone or something other than God. And unlike Jesus, who resisted this, as he did all temptation, we're all guilty of that at times. We can and should worship and serve God in every aspect of our daily lives. But we're constantly being tempted to serve this world and worship the false gods of approval and distraction and materialism and shifting standards. When I was preparing this talk, I realised how I never resisted the temptation to be sarcastic. I didn't even recognise this as a temptation to be resisted, but actually not everyone thinks sarcasm is funny. And sarcasm certainly isn't noble, true, right, pure, lovely, admirable or praiseworthy, the qualities that God wants us to focus on in our daily lives. So now when I say those words, lead us not into temptation, I'm asking God to lead me away from all temptations, including those I haven't even acknowledged. That's perhaps all of us wanting to press all buttons. So I'm trying to resist the temptation to say unkind things to people I don't like, the temptation to think it's okay not to like people, the temptation to go the other way when God has firmly pointed out a path to me. But as we said at the beginning of this service, this is not the end of the verse when we pray the Lord's Prayer. We say, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Actually, in some Bible versions, including the NIV that we use here in MLBC, the quote actually says,
lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.
Evil and evil one are very much two sides of the same coin. Jesus taught us that this plea to God follows on naturally from asking God to lead us not into temptation. We're asking God to lead us once more, this time away from evil, or the evil one. Now maybe you don't need me to tell you what evil means. When you go on the internet and search for images of evil, or the evil one, the devil, you get things like this. Or this. film or cartoon images, nothing you'd recognise in your own life. It's as if filmmakers and writers have had to create a fantastical fantasy version of evil because they can't think of any evil in our world. But they're wrong. Jesus has told us to pray this prayer because he knew we would encounter evil and we would need God's help to deliver us from it, constantly. Not scary monsters or aliens with terrifying weapons, but from the deliberate corruption and spoiling of his perfect creation, this amazing world, his amazing, much-loved children. Now, go back to temptations. High on the list, few of us can resist, is fresh crust of bread. Even the irresistible smell of it baking is enough to make some of us lose our minds. And Jesus ate bread. He used bread in his teaching. He commanded us to eat bread and remember him. I'm guessing he really loved bread. Bread is good. Now this is the same beautiful crusty bread once the world has got to it, neglected it, ignored it. It's become rotten, mouldy, and frankly disgusting. Evil works like that. It can come upon us quietly, subtly, spoiling what is good and beautiful. And we all need to be delivered from it. And although nowadays the word evil is only used to describe horrendous crimes, it's more insidious than that. There are degrees of evil. We all accept that cruelty is evil. Well, unkindness is a less dramatic version of cruelty, but can be equally destructive. And I know I have been guilty of unkindness many times, often just with casual words. I've neglected relationships with people, with the environment, with God. And I need to ask God to deliver me away from those tendencies, not just from the evil out there, but my own tendencies towards evil, every single day. So just as we know temptation is a daily challenge for which we need help, let's not pretend that evil only exists in Hollywood blockbusters or in distant history. When I try to kid myself that evil is just a melodramatic word and that temptation is just a funny series of anecdotes we all share with each other, I will remember that these were both so important to Jesus that he told us we couldn't handle them alone, that we would have to ask God for help and keep asking him. And just as evil doesn't have to be a monster in a devil's mask wreaking destruction on the Marvel universe, and just as temptation doesn't have to be Satan taunting me on a desert mountaintop, both challenges are part of my daily life and only God can help me overcome this. I will end with one of my top five favourite Bible quotes, which comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 10.
No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind, and God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear, but when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it.
I will cling to these words this week, and I hope you will too. So now, if you can stand if you're able and join us in song.
Thank you.
seated. Right, before Steve does his talk, we are now going to just have a brief session. On your table, you'll find lots of these little arrows. And grab an arrow. What I'd like everyone to do, they don't have to show other people what they're writing, is to write on it either something that they find as a temptation that they have, over which they seem to have no control whatsoever, or it might be some kind of evil that worries you or frightens you, or it might even be a tendency towards evil that you have in yourself. Most of us do, but if you'd like to do that. And then when you've done that, I'd like you to take it over the board there where you see a cross. And then when you get there, I'd like you to turn it over so you can't see those words anymore and pin it so it's facing the cross. Because as soon as you get back on that right path and you head towards the cross, towards God, those temptations, that evil, can be overcome. So I'll give you a few minutes to do that.
Yes, he made me sign a certificate saying I'd approved his talk.
Some of you may have recognised my walk-on music as being the theme from Darth Vader, the character from Star Wars. Woohoo! Okay. Now, the reason for this was that the very first thought I had come into my head when I read the title for today's service, Lead Us Not in Temptation, but Deliver Us from Evil, taken from the Lord's Prayer. For those that have never seen Star Wars, Darth Vader is a baddie. Ooh, okay. As mentioned, as per usual, my talks, some of my ideas are immediately vetoed by Francesca, Madam Secretary. So you all missed out on me dressing up in full Darth Vader kit, walking onto stage to the theme music, with smoke and a red laser sword. So may the force be with you. I thought it best to start my talk with a quick refresh. The Lord's Prayer as we know it today originates from the Gospel of Matthew in an extract of the Sermon on the Mount. It came about after the disciples had come to Jesus to learn how to pray. He taught them the Lord's Prayer that was transcribed by Matthew during this occasion. The Lord's Prayer is also recorded in the Gospel of Luke. We think Jesus probably taught his disciples in Aramaic. Only the Greek translation of this prayer are available to us, okay, in the Gospel of Luke and Matthew. Those versions have actually been modified of the original text, and all the text now is in every living language we know on earth, Spanish, French, Italian, German, etc. So that we can all say the same prayer together. So, sitting in my man cave, off conversion, waiting for inspiration for today's talk, my thoughts began to focus on just two of the words, temptation and evil. What, if any, are the differences in the meaning of the words from the time when they were initially spoken by Jesus to now and in the world we live in today? Were the temptations similar to any of the ones we have in our lives? Does evil come in forms other than the devil? So let me offer you some of the temptations we can compare and some that be a bit different. In the Bible, the word greed is mentioned many times and is often connected to the stories relating to tax collectors. Matthew had been a dishonest collector driven by greed until Jesus chose him as a disciple. He thought money was the most important thing in his life, and he violated God's laws to enrich himself at the expense of his countrymen. In Luke, we are told about Zacchaeus, who climbed a tree to see Jesus and then ate with him, but was guilty of the love of money, and according to his confession, he had employed shady means to make money. Judas, one of the 12 disciples, betrayed Jesus for just 30 pieces of silver. What you may not know about him is that he also stole money that had been contributed to the Jesus ministry of the day. Not nice. The comparison to today is we often see examples of greed connected to banking, share dealing, scamming schemes, landlords, and more. Does anyone know how many zeros you need to add to a one to make it a billion? Anyone?
Nine.
Yeah, you're right, nine. Yeah, nine zeros make a billion. Okay. According to the internet, a man called Bernard Arnault is the richest person on earth by having a whopping $210.8 billion. I mean, what would you do with that? Have you been tempted by greed of money? Throughout time, there have been criminals, okay? The men crucified with Jesus were criminals, robbers and bandits, whose flouting of Roman law got them crucified. The parable of the Good Samaritan starts with a crime that had been committed, leaving a traveller stripped of clothing, beaten, and left half dead. The Bible contains numerous examples of individuals who are guilty of crimes, such as murder, adultery, theft, perjury, or treason. Each day we can find examples that have been committed. Turn on the TV, read a newspaper, scroll through the internet pages. The rate of shoplifting in England and Wales has hit a highest level for more than two decades. The cost of living crisis is widely acknowledged as one of the biggest driving forces in the growing number of incidents of shoplifting as household spending becomes squeezed. The temptation to turn to crime to see other people getting away with making an easy living and feeling pulled towards a path are similar from then to today. Right, this one is for the ladies initially. Crystal's getting excited, I don't know who she's seen. All right, if we just have the next one for now and then. Okay, and this is just for make it equal, all right? Okay, so who catches your eye? Okay, for the men, we've got that. For the women, we've got the other one, okay? I did chuckle when within a few days of Charles becoming king, comments and stories began appearing about his dishy, handsome equerry, Lieutenant Colonel Johnny Thompson. When you're born with rugged good looks, okay, it can be a burden. Don't you agree? The men's breakfast attendees, Al, Rick, etc. Such a burden. The Bible is filled with stories of infidelity and unfaithfulness, from David and Bathsheba to Samson and Delilah. Past and present film stars, politicians, celebrities, and the royalty. The media love disclosing the infidelities when they discover them. This is an age-old temptation, going back to the beginning of human history, and probably the hardest to defeat. This is my temptation. Okay. The best ever girl pop group, okay? I could never decide as to which one I would marry first. Sorry. Okay. We could stay on this slide all day for me, but we've got to move on a bit. So, next, please. Okay. If you have the option to cut your own slice of cake, how big a bit can you get away with? Temptation. Okay. Next one, please. Okay. We live in a world where illicit drugs consumption is prevalent. Not one day goes by that we do not hear about or read about lives lost to drug abuse. Drugs as we know them today were virtually non-existent during the time of the Bible, and other temptations were available. A change in circumstances, physical or mental health issues, or just an attraction to something new to try can be the reason to be tempted by drugs. The Bible does not specifically condemn gambling, betting, or the lottery. The Bible does warn us, however, against the love of money. One example of gambling in the Bible can be found when the Roman guards at the foot of the cross divided the garments worn by Jesus among themselves by casting lots, therefore were gambling. When I was growing up, each member of my family would choose a horse when the Grand National Horse Race was on. The choice was often made because we liked the name of the horse or the colours that the jockey was wearing. My favourite uncle, who liked to bet, would then place a £1 bet for all of us. I think my sister once won £5. Thankfully, none of us became addicted to gambling. The first draw of the UK lottery took place on the 19th of November 1994. You can now participate in the lottery every day of the week and buy numerous scratch cards in the hope of winning a life-changing amount. What a temptation. Because I can. There we go. All right. Can we stay on this one longer? No. All right. So, okay. Next one, please. All right. Origin of ice cream can be traced back to the 4th century BC and was likely brought from China back to Europe. Over time, recipes for ices, sherbets and milk ices evolved and were served in the fashionable Italian and French royal courts. The first ice cream parlour in America opened in New York in 1776, ages ago. When Francesca and I are away on holiday, we usually go looking for ice creams as one of our daily treats. With so many flavours and toppings, it can be hard to choose, and then you have to decide how many scoops. At home, you get all sorts of ice creams and lollies that are available to add to your weekly shopping. Can you resist them? Sometimes, because some temptations are easier to resist than others, but it's still a constant challenge. Not just at Christmas can you be tempted by the choice of which one to take first. If, like me, you have a particular favourite, depending on which selection box, it can get a bit stressful when someone else starts to take the ones you like. Okay? The temptation is to take more than one of the box that you like. Or is that just me? Have you been tempted to look at your phone during a church service? Just checking. Oh, I've lost myself now. Oh yeah, okay. Right. And if you are looking at your phone, is it for something other than a Bible verse? Okay. Well, I had to resist last week checking the BBC Sport when the England cricket team were playing in a must-win cricket match against India. We lost, Burrow's very good. I didn't look at my phone, found out later. One of the things that bemuses me about social media is influencers. Okay? It's probably because of my age, young 40-ish, something like that, that I do not get this. Okay? Yes, I can be persuaded by adverts, but influenced by someone? The position of influencer in my life is already taken by my lovely wife, Francesca. Bonus points there, bonus points. Unfortunately, social media is not all good, and the young can be particularly vulnerable to being lured into things. The internet has given us many wonderful things. Instant messaging, movies on demand, online gaming. But social media is addictive, really addictive. And addiction means that temptation has won. I was amused by a cartoon I saw in a newspaper where it had a whole family with mobiles in hand sitting at the Christmas dinner table. And each had a speech bubble depicting that texting the other people on the table. They weren't speaking, they were texting. Another one that I had seen is of a young child in a nursery asking for the Wi-Fi code because the pages on the book they had in front of them were not swiping right. Okay. Oh, can I get away with another one? Yes, I can. Oh, put it back. Not so quick. Right, okay. Yeah, thank you. So these are just a few examples of the temptations we can be led to. Do we need more than willpower to resist? The Star Wars films gave me a good example with Luke Skywalker, he's the guy in the white, the goodie, who is being trained in the art of the Force. It's not magic, it's the Force. He starts to get vision of Darth Vader, the baddie, who is on the dark side of the Force. He's encouraged to resist going to the dark side by the person assisting with the training, his master, Obi-Wan Kenobi, the guy in the hood. He does resist. And amazingly, we all have the same options through our Christian beliefs and trust in God to resist temptations. Now, we get to the bit where we deliver us from evil. All right. I did think of starting this part with a loud evil cackle being played on the sound system. All right. Don't worry, I realise that that was maybe not a good idea, as it may scare some people into leaving, and we need all the church members to stay for the church meeting. I think that throughout the ages, people have recognised the devil, Satan, Lucifer and Beelzebub as being the thing that associate with evil. Christians have traditionally interpreted the serpent in the Garden of Eden as a devil due to what is written in Revelation. The great dragon was hurled down, the ancient serpent called the devil of Satan, who leads the world into astray. He was hurled down to the earth and his angels with him. So that's where we get that one from. The first evil person most people come across in the Bible is this guy, through the telling of the birth of Jesus. The three wise men visited King Herod on their journey to follow the star. They avoided going back to him to tell him about Jesus. Herod the Great, as he was known, tried to have Jesus killed, and in the process had many children killed. He was not a nice person. When I was growing up in Birmingham, my mum used to save up the child allowance and take me as a treat to see the latest blockbuster in the cinema. On one of these occasions was the first time I experienced of evil. This is a character in the film Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. Anyone know who he is? Yeah, the Chalk Catcher. I mean, how evil. Okay. The Chalker. On that occasion, I managed to not be so scared and overwhelmed and had to leave the cinema. Not so when I came across this character. Sorry, Crystal. Who's this? Wicked Witch, yeah, I know. Every time the film was on TV, my mum would tell the story of how we had to leave the cinema with me screaming and in floods of tears when I saw this character. Thankfully, when Star Wars was shown in the cinema, I was a teenager and brave enough to see it all by myself. Other known baddies include these. Do we recognise some of these? Yeah, mostly from Disney stuff. They all have baddies. Okay. Numerous history books cover the lives and activities of people who, by what they did as an individual or as a leader, have been accepted as being evil. Millions of people throughout the world have been affected by events beyond their control.